the Science History Institute at 315 Chestnut Street, Philadelphia. It's in this gorgeous old building. And it's jammed with equipment that looks like it came out of the labs where I worked at the University of Pennsylvania for 18 years. This is I walked through this exhibit a couple of months ago, and it really talks about people who've made a difference, who realized things were just not that great in Philadelphia and they fixed them. Okay, there's a person here, I don't want to get him in the video. I hope this isn't him. And here are the acknowledgements. We all live downstream. See, that's the problem. Plastic saves lives, but it also can be deadly. It's like plastic is an azeotrope. Spectrophotometer. I use plenty of those. What you do is you put something in solution, and you have controls, and you figure out how much you have. A very simplistic way of looking at it. Clean water was once a local problem. But as the population grew, industries expanded. It's like no one realized that living next to a river, which was used for water, could end up being deadly. I'm sure some people realize it. That's the thing, though. I mean, the billionaires at the top don't see what's going on. Little people have to explain. And often these little people are scientists who have data. Look at that, 1964, 1967 Japan, 1974 India, Mexico. So that's part of good governance, making sure the water's clean. This looks like I don't know what it is. Fluorite. Did we do? Okay, it's a sampler. So this is about the Delaware River. Gosh. Just to put everything in context. Like this. How did we know? Killing bugs, DDT, horrible poisons, but it's always a dance between things that want to live and other things that want to live. It's like a war. So that's the Delaware River Basin. That's where I live, in Haddonville. And this is West Philadelphia, and the University of West Philadelphia, and the University of Pennsylvania. There's a huge basin. So what's interesting, so for the first time, people could actually see where they lived and where the river was. That's an amazing model. Okay, what did we do? Well, there's a whole lot of men in suits, one guy in a bow tie. Yeah, they're all men. But it wasn't the men that did all the work. Mongoloid dog. Mongoloid duck. Yeah, Dr. Ruth Patrick, she is very well known at the Academy of Natural Sciences and should be well known everywhere. She did extraordinary work. And she invented a diatometer. And that's the diatometer. There's her diatoms. Oh, how lovely. So there's Ruth and Mara. So we have Lois. And just to put things in context, this model here, this is the Delaware River, all the way down here. This is the Delaware River. It goes all the way down to the Atlantic Ocean. This is all New Jersey. And this is the Schuylkill River. So the Delaware River divides New Jersey and Pennsylvania and goes all the way up. And that was the issue. And this is a very interesting part here. Dams on the Delaware River. Because the north of the Delaware River heads towards New York, I believe. So they wanted all kinds of dams along here. Luckily, they weren't built. Prohibition on dams. Here we are, 1962, the Tox Island Dam Project, which didn't happen. And the Delaware River is the longest free-flowing river east of the Mississippi. No dam blocks the river. It's 330-mile flow, from New York down to the Atlantic Ocean. Wow. That was very lucky. Okay, I'm going to stop this here and take some... Wait a minute, I forgot this right here. Did Philadelphia succeed? Look at this lovely picture here. Okay, part two coming up.